Hi, Miss April.
Oh, hi, guys. Hezekiah, I'm so glad you're here. You'll be really interested in who we're learning about today. It's King Hezekiah.
Oh, that's who I'm named after.
I thought that might be the case.
Well, Hezekiah and Beulah and my cousin Hephzibah and Papaw's neighbor, Mr. Moses, they ain't the only ones with names from the Bible. I found out my name is in the Bible, too.
Really? I don't remember ever reading about a Billy in the Bible.
Daniel 8.
Your name is in Daniel 8? My life group just finished a study in the book of Daniel, and I certainly don't remember there being a Billy mentioned.
It's in there, Miss April.
Billy, this is the chapter that describes one of Daniel's visions about a ram and a goat.
Right. A ram and a billy goat.
It just says goat.
Well, what other kind of goat is there besides a billy goat?
Oh, there are nanny goats and mountain goats and wild goats and 200 breeds of domesticated goats. Alpine, La Mancha, Sable, Fainting goats.
Oh,
but it could have been a billy goat.
And Billy, most people don't have names from the Bible. Mine isn't.
Oh, well, the month of Nisan on the Hebrew calendar is mentioned in the Bible, and that alternates between March and April in the Gregorian calendar.
See, you're in there after all, Miss April.
Why don't we get back to our original subject, Hezekiah?
Yes, Miss April?
I mean King Hezekiah.
Oh.
He was 25 years old when he became the king of Judah, and he was one of the good kings.
What made him a good king? Did he give everybody free cookies?
No, what made him good was the way he obeyed God and did things God's way. This was remarkable because his father, King Ahaz, was very evil. He worshipped idols and even closed up the temple so that no one could go and worship the one true God.
Remind me again what an idol is?
An idol is anything someone worships that isn't God. When Hezekiah's father was king, everyone worshipped statues and did lots of awful things as they worshipped false gods.
So King Hezekiah didn't do all that?
No. In fact, in his first month of being king, he had the temple opened up and repaired, and then all the people of Judah helped tear down the idols and places where false gods had been worshipped.
It sounds like he got everything all spick and span, whatever that is.
It's a cleaner. And yes, he did get all of Judah cleaned up.
What happened next, Miss April?
After he restored worship in the temple and had all the idols destroyed, God blessed Hezekiah and things were pretty peaceful in Judah. But in the 14th year of Hezekiah's reign...
25 years old plus 14. Oh, he was 39 years old then.
That's right. When he was 39, the king of Assyria, Sennacherib, came to attack the land of Judah. King Hezekiah agreed to pay the Assyrians to leave them alone, and they demanded 22,500 pounds of silver and 2,250 pounds of gold. That is over $74 million in today's economy.
Good grief. How was King Hezekiah supposed to get $74 million worth of silver and gold?
It was hard to scrape up. He took all of the silver he had saved, and to get enough gold, he had to take it off the doors and columns of the temple, which he'd put on earlier when the temple was being restored.
Oh, that's disappointing.
Well, I'm sure he thought it was worth it to avoid a war with the Assyrians. Just 8 years earlier, the Assyrians had attacked the much larger northern kingdom of Israel and taken them away as captives. They weren't an army that you'd want to fight against.
Did paying them the 24,750 pounds of silver and gold make them go away?
Nope. After taking their payment, the king of Assyria still sent a great army to Jerusalem, which was Judah's capital city.
Oh no. Now what was King Hezekiah going to do?
Well, he trusted God to help them. He gathered all the people together who could help defend the city, and he told them not to be afraid because they had the Lord to help them fight their battles. King Hezekiah's faith in God helped reassure all the people.
Oh, good.
They needed that encouragement for what was about to happen next.
Oh, goodness, what happened?
Did the Assyrians have a big old giant to help them fight like the Philistines did?
Did they walk around the wall for 7 days and then let out a shout to make Jerusalem's walls fall down?
Did they use 300 foxes to burn up all their crops?
No, but I'm glad to hear that you guys remember our lessons on David and Goliath, Joshua and the Battle of Jericho, and Samson. The king of Assyria sent a message to Hezekiah and the people of Jerusalem.
Oh, wow. A message to all the people in Jerusalem? That would have been a big old group message. Our baseball team has a group chat, and whenever the coach sends out a message, everybody comments and likes it and comments on the comments. I can't even watch the Braves on my phone for all the texts popping up every second. And there's only 15 of us in the group.
Oh, by the way, I really enjoyed your coded message yesterday. It took me a few minutes to decipher the encryption, but I got it figured out.
Do what now?
Remember, the coach sent a message that we're having our team pictures taken before practice tomorrow, and you responded with the number 3 followed by a star, a red crayon, and a frog emoji.
A 3, a star, a red crayon, and a frog emoji?
That was a really clever way to say that the photographer should use the rule of thirds, a 6.2mm star filter, and red eye reduction technology to reduce fundal reflex. I think the frog emoji represents an amphibious camera, but we shouldn't be under the water.
Oh, good grief. My little brother, Booger Ray, he must have got a hold of my phone again. He's always getting it and sending random stuff and making me look ridiculous. I think the 3 and the star was because he got 3 stars on his behavior chart last month. The crayon's probably because he likes to color, and the frog is because he loves them. The other day he rescued one from his kiddie pool and put it in Beulah's bed so it could rest. He didn't get a star that day.
Oh.
Hey, why don't we get back to talking about King Hezekiah?
Oh, yeah, Miss April. How did the king of Assyria get everybody's number to send him a message?
Well, it wasn't a text message because there were no cell phones in Bible times. He sent someone to deliver the message in person.
What was the message?
The messenger said that the people of Judah shouldn't rely on their God to save them. He pointed out how Hezekiah had destroyed all their idols and altars and had the people worship only at the temple.
Oh, but those things they'd destroyed were just statues that someone had made. They weren't really God.
That's right. But the messenger thought that the God that Judah was trusting in was like all the idols that had no power. He was giving this message in Hebrew, so King Hezekiah's officials asked him to speak in the Syrian language, which they also knew. They didn't want the people of Jerusalem who were listening to be able to understand him.
Did he speak to them in Aramaic?
Ara what?
Aramaic, that's the ancient Syrian language.
No, he didn't. He continued speaking in Hebrew, which was the language of Judah, and he shouted loudly so that everyone who was guarding the wall of the city could hear the rest of his message.
What was it?
He pointed out that none of the gods of the other nations had been able to keep the Assyrians from defeating them, and they should not believe that God could either. He kept telling them that they should come out of the walled city of Jerusalem and surrender.
Did they do it?
No, they kept quiet and stayed put just like King Hezekiah had told them to. The messenger also left a letter that said the same thing that he had announced, and when he had left, Hezekiah took the letter into the temple with him to pray.
Why did he take the letter in there?
Well, King Hezekiah spread it out before the Lord and showed the Lord what the Assyrians had said about him not being able to help them. Of course, God already knew what the letter said, but it was Hezekiah's way of giving the problem to God. You know, we can do the same thing.
What do you mean?
Whenever we receive a bad report, we can spread it out before the Lord and we can pray.
Like when we get a bad grade on a test?
A bad grade on a test?
Yes. Any kind of bad news. A medical diagnosis? An unexpected bill?
A letter from MIT saying you have to finish elementary school before you can apply to their university?
Yeah. So King Hezekiah prayed, and God had the prophet Isaiah send him a message.
Oh, I'm guessing that wasn't a text message either, huh?
No.
Miss April, was that the Isaiah who wrote the Old Testament book of the Bible called Isaiah?
Yes, it was. Isaiah was a prophet, which meant that God would let him know something that was about to happen, and then he would tell everyone about it.
What was the message?
God had told him that because Hezekiah had prayed that he was going to defend Jerusalem, the Assyrians would not come into the city or even shoot a single arrow there.
Oh, that's good news. How'd he do it?
That very night, the angel of the Lord went into the camp of the Assyrians, and 185,000 of their soldiers died. Without his big army, Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, left and went back home to Nineveh and didn't bother the kingdom of Judah again.
Oh, that must have been a huge relief to King Hezekiah.
Yes, but right after that, when Hezekiah was still 39 years old, he got very sick. So sick that God sent Isaiah to tell him that he was going to die.
Oh, no.
Oh, did he have cardiomyopathy?
No.
Encephalomyocarditis?
The croup?
The Bible says he had a boil, which is a sore on the skin. It must have gotten really infected.
Oh, it was probably sepsis.
Oh, what happened to him?
Well, when Hezekiah heard that he was going to die, he turned his face to the wall and began praying. He asked God to remember all the good things he had done and how he had obeyed God. Then he started crying.
Oh, this is heartbreaking.
Before Isaiah had even left the palace, God sent him back to tell Hezekiah that he was going to recover in 3 days and live another 15 years.
Oh, good. Now he would be super duper old when he died.
54 years old.
Yeah, that's really old, all right. Hezekiah asked for a sign that he was going to get better.
Oh, I guess he couldn't wait 3 whole days to find out.
Well, it seems like he would have just trusted what God had said, but God gave him a sign on the sundial that Hezekiah's father had built.
King Ahaz.
That's right. The sun's shadow went backwards 10 degrees, which never happens. It's kind of like the numbers on a clock going back 20 minutes.
Oh, that's cool. So I'm guessing he got better?
Yes, and just like God said, he lived 15 more years. 3 years after he was healed, his son Manasseh was born, and he's the one who became king when Hezekiah died.
Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king?
Yes, and sadly, he was a very, very bad king. He rebuilt all the idols and altars to false gods that Hezekiah had destroyed, and he did a lot of evil things.
Oh, you'd think Hezekiah would have done a better job of raising him. They needed my mama to straighten Manasseh out. She would have had him doing so many chores, he wouldn't have had time to think about doing bad stuff.
No one misbehaves around Mrs. Higgins.
Oh, except Booker Ray. Even my mama can't get him to act right.
Oh, thank you so much for telling us about King Hezekiah, Miss April. I enjoyed learning about my namesake immensely.
Maybe next time we can learn about that billy goat from Daniel 8.
Well, I'm sure we will be talking about Daniel sometime soon.
All right. Well, bye, Miss April.
Bye, guys.